considered it, I have prayed about it, and I asked them, Lord, give me one word that will summarize why people become broke. And the Lord said, people become broke because they make the wrong choices. So it's about our choices in life. We are either it's guarded, it's not guarded, we're making foolish decisions, we're making incomplete decisions. So it's about our decisions, it's not about what we think it is. It's about the decisions that we made. And the Lord said to me this morning, he said, Hebrews 4. He said, now there is rest. For one, now there is rest. There is promise of rest to those that believe. Those that will seek me, there is rest. And once you have that rest, once you know that rest, your mindset is changed. Once you know that there is rest, once you know that there is rest that is available, there is promise of rest, everything in your life becomes different. So it's about choices that you make. The Israelites leaving Egypt, they made a choice. They made a choice because that Hebrews 4 was actually talking about Exodus, it's talking about Exodus 13. It's talking about, Numbers 13. When God said to Moses that let them go and spy out the promised land. And they went and to spy out the promised land. And by the time they got there, they said, God was excited, but they were not excited. And said, you will not come into my rest. Because you have refused to go and claim the thing I told you to claim, you will not come into my rest. And being rest is where the position you find the Jews at that time, they could not come into their promised land. And as long as you're not in your promised land, you cannot find financial rest. You have no peace of mind. And let me tell you, talking about finances, talking about being successful, there is nobody that is within you that is turmoil and strife and you'll be successful. Success comes as a result of peace of mind. Because when you have peace of mind, you are able to critically analyze and think through things.
You cannot be broke and thinking in a negative way and be able to achieve something positive. It's not possible. It's not possible. I've talked a lot about mind, but today I don't want to go there. So the first thing that you need to do, because it's now being broke, is about the choices that you make, the associations that you have, the business partners that you have, the friends that you have, the kind of job that you decide, the kind of job that you decide to. Let me read, if you have your Bible, let us go to 2 Corinthians so that we can understand 2 Corinthians. You would have heard me a lot of times talk about it, so that you know that the Lord has something in store for you. How you are supposed to conduct yourself. Sorry, 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And I'll read. It says, however, we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age, who are coming to nothing. But we speak wisdom of God in a mystery. We speak wisdom of God in a mystery. The hidden wisdom which God ordained. Hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages for our glory. Which none of the rulers of this age knew. For had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But it is written, and this is directed to you, eyes have not seen, nor ears heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. Is someone still with me?
Yes, sir.
Now let's begin to get into what I want, verse 10. But God has revealed them. What is that them? The mysteries. God has revealed those things that have no, eyes have not seen, nor entered the heart of man. God has revealed it to us through what? His Spirit. His Holy Spirit, which is the most redundant God ever alive. There are many gods, and those gods are very active. The gods of the Juju priest is very active because he has many visitors coming to him. But we have the Holy Spirit, which is the resident God on earth, but is hardly utilized. Every day is crying. Proverbs 3, 4, 5. Say, when you read Proverbs and you see, when you say, and the woman is shouting, wisdom is shouting at the mountaintop, he's talking about the Holy Spirit. Shouting, I am redundant. I am sent to you to be your comforter. I am sent to you to be your counselor. I have wisdom. Proverbs 8, he said, through me, God created the things that he created. But yet, he's the most idle God. He's the most idle God that I know of. But God has revealed him through his Spirit. For the Spirit now
searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. The Holy Spirit searches all. For what man knows the things of man except the Spirit of man, which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Holy Spirit of God. Now we have received not the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit of who is from God, now that we might know the things that have been freely given unto us by God. That we might know the things that are freely given unto us. So if you do not know how to use the Holy Spirit, if you do not know how to access the Holy Spirit, then you will continue to make mistakes and fail. So it is a bad choice not to be able to know how to utilize the Holy Spirit. Bad choice. It is a bad choice to enter business first, then you bring God into the business after. It's a bad choice that you start business and God is not the senior partner. Bad choice. It's a bad choice that you have a partnership, an associate that God did not lead you to, or you did not pray and say, God, show me the heart of this man. Bad choice. Because if you do, he has said, he will reveal those things unto you. Put your trust in me. Acknowledge me in all your ways. Lean not on your own understanding, and I will direct
your path. How can we say, where is God? Which mouth are we going to use to say, where is this God that I serve? When he has given you all that pertains to life and godliness through his word. So you cannot say you did not know. You see, in this life, ignorance is not an excuse. You can be tongue-talking. Eh? You can be tongue-talking, heaven-bound, but wallowing in poverty on earth.
Yes, sir.
You can be heaven-bound and die of sickness on earth. It's your choice. Because if you do not utilize the weapons and the arsenal God has given to you, it will not. But you know the good thing is, wherever you are, if you will repent, if you will go to God and say, God, I have made a mistake, he will not cast you out.
Yes, yes, yes.
He will bring you in.
Yes, yes.
So, because they say the day you wake up, that's your morning. So your morning can be at 60 years, it's not a problem. The man that started KFC, Was it not in his late 60s, almost 70 started? That was his money. But he was able to leave a legacy. A mature single came to me and was crying. I said, look, I'm above over 45. I've not gotten married. And I said to her, which one is better? To have married from at the age of 25 and be in hell, and to marry at the age of 50, he said, Pastor, I shouldn't go. I said, to be married at the age of 50 and have 20 years of blissful life. I said, choose which one you want, then I'll pray with you. He said, but that he wants to marry now. I said, choose. Are you going to do it with God? This woman is married to a French woman as we speak, and she married at 50 years that we agreed.
Wow.
Having the best of lives. She doesn't have a child, but she has children that live. She's impacting society and impacting the world. And taking care of the man's children and bringing Christ into the home. Which one do you choose? Which one do you want? With God, he might look and say, I'm aging. But God doesn't move in time. He's not constrained with time. But his will and his counsel will stand.
Amen.
So it doesn't matter. If God says he will open door for you at 70, you can cry all you want. It's at 70, at the mark of 70, that things will turn around. But Lord, God has said to me, this thing that you are doing is because it's overdue for my people. Change their mentality. Every time you come here, what I'm trying to do is to change your mind and prepare you for the things that God has, because it's overdue. And as when you come to the fullness of time in the knowledge of what God wants you to know, you'll be surprised. Everything will begin to fall to you in pleasant places. So what do I do when I'm broke? Number one, look for help in the right places. Start with God. See, start with God. Before anything, start with God. Matthew 11:28. Come to me, all you that labor and are heavy laden and are overburdened. I will cause you to rest. I will ease and relieve and refresh your soul. Amplified version. Come to me, you that labor and heavy laden. God knows you are dressed. Run to him first. It's not working out. Then you need to halt everything and take time out. You have tried business, it's not working, it failed. Take time out, regroup. Now with God, come again. If you are in business, you cannot stop operations. Take time, take a week. I told a man, I said, look, take a week, go and seek the face of God. Let him restructure and give you a new blueprint for the future. Because if you call on God and say, God, I want to serve you, what if you are as a business person, in your mind, you say, God, give me wealth. In God's mind, God is looking for a faithful person. He will give money that will channel his money to his kingdom work. Is somebody hearing me?
Yes, sir.
So, supporting your church, supporting what we do here, and supporting all kingdom work is how you pay God dividend. So a mind that understands these things, it becomes easy. It becomes easy for you to flow with God. So if it's not working, stop. If you have started business, then God must become your senior partner. I've preached that many times.
Yes, sir.
Go back on Facebook, you can see all my messages there. On YouTube, you can see quite a lot after. So you need to halt and find out what is God saying. Because when you bring two people are doing this, you know, we We don't look at God sometimes as a personality. But he is.
Yes.
He has his own desires. He has his own will. And you know what? Do you know that God is handicapped? Let me mess up your theology. Do you know that God is handicapped? And let me tell you how he's handicapped. God can never do anything on earth without man.
Yes.
So if them coming together will produce somebody like you. So two of them had to come together so that they can produce you. So you can fulfill the God's work on earth. Let me give you a story. My from the family I come from, we are only going to supposed to marry from different from certain families. They're not supposed to marry from outside those families because of the family which we come from. There are five families you must marry from those five families. In fact, if it gets so bad that there are no women to more women than men, they give you three wives or four wives at that time. But it stopped at my father's time because they stopped it. So my father was supposed to marry my mother's elder sister. So he went abroad. He didn't come back on time, and women don't wait at that time, so they married him. But because there's already a bond, he came back and he married my mom. And one day they were talking, I said, it did not work because it was for me now. I had to come. That my auntie doesn't have the thing inside of her to give birth to me. It has to be two of them. You don't understand.
Yeah.
That's why I showed up.
That's
why God frustrated me, because I needed to come. If I did not come, you will not be hearing me today. Because if two of them are married, we will not be here. Both my cousins and my siblings will not be here. A different set. So but what I'm feeling in my spirit, God wants, see, this thing that is happening to you, God is excited. I say God is excited by you being broke. God is excited by your business not working. You know why? He wants you to come to him so that he can change it.
Yeah.
He can give you a new blueprint. What you need to know about God is that he gives you things on a need-to-know basis.
Yeah.
He blesses you in phases. He does not bless you all at the same time. And he gives you strength for a phase. So that strength that you have for now has expired. Some of us were trying to do the work with expired strength. It don't expire. It can't work. You know, you are calling heaven, but the number has been, that recharge, that card has been used. It's not going through because you need to go afresh. You need to go back afresh and get it from him. So please, when things are not working, it's for you to halt. I told a man, I said, look, take 1 week. He said his business will fold up. I said, the way you are going, this business will fold up. Because if God has said something, man also still needs to break it down for you. So you're going to ask God, and during our prayer session, you're going to ask God to lead you to earthly mentors. Because you also need, you have me here to break it down for you. What God is saying. But you also need, in your own industry, an experienced colleague that can break down some of the things. So let God lead you to men that can counsel you. Because what I have seen in Christendom, you go to men to counsel you, they derail you. It becomes the issue of the old prophet and the new prophet. But I'll leave that alone. So seek for help in the right places. Seek God first. And when you seek God first, he begins to put a burden for other things inside of you. Example, he begins to put a burden for you to belong to this business group, for you to belong to this association. Do you know there's a guy that God led to his village meeting? We were discussing. I said, he said, do I go to village meeting? I said, do they know me? Do I know them? How would they even come to ask me? Do they even know me? If we see ourselves in the street, would they know me? He said, I shouldn't say that kind of thing, no. That they just finished night vigil with him and the wife. And he was telling the wife that the Lord is impressing that he should go to his village meeting. Is it not how he went to his village meeting? They first of all told him that he needs to pay for 3 years or 5 years. He hasn't, since he came to Port Harcourt, they've been, you know. So after a while, he said he was upset. They came, they broke down the money. You know, they accepted him. You know, in village meeting, they harass you and abuse you and do all those things. So he started, he said, well, he doesn't understand. But on the second visit, one of his uncles came and said, stupid boy, I've been looking for you. They say you are doing this. What are you? Come and meet me in Abuja. And that was the end of the story for him. Village meeting. See, so, but also village meeting can be bad for you. Because village meeting is the center of competition. Where families compete with each other and they are willing to go to any extent to bring you down. But if God sends you, God will protect you.
Yeah, that's right.
If they invite you for village meeting, then you also need to take it to God. Should I go or should I not go? So what it very really means is that work with God in what you're saying, in what in there to find out what he's saying. Number two, please, I beg of you, stop the blame game. Stop blaming. Stop it. Stop it. You cannot be blaming and be moving forward at the same time. I know some of you, I know that some of you were wronged. Some of you, a colleague set you up and you were sacked. Some of you, your problem is a human being that caused it. Some of you, I do also agree that your tribe has caused it. I also agree that all those things you are saying, I agree that those things are possible. But those things should not limit you. Because there is one that has the writing. There is one that wrote your history. And he did not put those people. Those people are part of the hurdle that you need to. Don't say my mother didn't train me, my father trained me. See, those things are past. You should be grateful that they are the vehicles that brought you to earth. Some people don't even know their fathers. Some people don't even know their mothers. Forget about school. He has come, he has gone. You didn't do well in school, fine. But it's the end that justifies the means. Because the ones that did first class, that had first class in university, are not the richest today. If so, professors will be the richest. But it doesn't work that way. What is it that you are looking and thinking that is limiting you? You need to stop the blame game today. Someone say, I will stop it. Whatever, even if it's genuine, let it go, forgive. And move on. Because God says, if you do not forgive, I will not forgive you also. Many people are stuck today because they feel that they could have gotten better, gone higher, if not for this thing that happened to them. And it's eating up in your mind. See, blame and regret, it makes you, it freezes you, and you stay in one place. You keep thinking, oh, if only I did not make this, if not because of this mistake, I made a wrong choice. Yes, you made a wrong choice. That's why we are in this class today. You made a wrong choice. But it's now time for you to unlearn it and move forward. This is where I am. This is where I want to go. This man brought me back, but it's okay. I am wiser. You know, sometimes if you do not have any mishap, you will not appreciate peace.
Yes, sir.
You will not appreciate the goodness of God. Sometimes things need to happen to us so that we will have sense. Mm. I, there are certain things I'm dealing with right now. And I was so surprised, and I just asked the Holy Spirit, where is this thing coming from? And the Holy Spirit started bringing out, you know, careless thought, all of them begin to crystallize. And I told you last week, your thoughts will, you are a combination of your thoughts, but it doesn't end there. You are the product of your thought, but that thought will now begin, your thought will now begin to bring about circumstances that happen to you. Whatever you are thinking, if you are thinking negative thoughts, it brings those things. After a while, it begins to bring those things you are thinking. If you are afraid of armed robber and you are afraid of kidnappers and you have that fear and you don't deal with it, sooner than later you are going to see what you have. Because whatever is in your heart is going to come to pass. You know why Genesis 1:26, I said it here, and I said God created us in his own image and likeness. That is divinity that he put within us, that we can use that divinity to alter our humanity to our own taste. So you must recreate and rebuild your world and rule your world. And how do you do it? By your thoughts. So stop blaming and start thinking. Stop blaming who did what to you. Yes, it's justified. I'm telling you on behalf of God today. Sorry, move on.
Amen.
Sorry. That person that I'm saying sorry on their behalf. Please let it go. Sorry, move on. Move on. Life, there's a lot of life out there. That move on. Number three. Figure out why you don't have any money. Critically analyze why you do not have any money. Because if you don't know, if you cannot locate your mistake, then you know that there's no help coming to you. Where did I make mistake? Where did I get it wrong? If you don't know it and recognize it, you will not be able to move forward. And let me give you an example. Let me use like 5 questions to explain that. Are you spending more money than you have got? Are you spending more than what is coming in? You know, it's just a matter of time you'll be broke.
Yes.
Do you need a prophet to tell you that?
No.
Number 2, are you living today off money you are expecting to receive tomorrow? Some people, once they hear that they are going to pay you, somebody has got to collect that they are going to pay contract. Then it was 1.5 million. He has said, I need to buy a car. He said, this Toyota Camry is entering my eye too much. And he went, borrowed money and bought that Toyota Camry. But what he didn't realize is that money did not come until after 8 months. So now he had to borrow money to pay off, and he realized that for the next 2 to 3 years, he was always borrowing money to meet up. Don't borrow. Accountants say money in that is not in the bank is no money. Don't do budgets on money that has not entered, you've not gotten allowed for. Do not do that. Are you spending money you do not have to compensate for other areas of your life? Say, lady, I know. I told her one of these days. Lady, sorry, but there has to be boundary in everything. There's some people that will make up. Yeah, it's like I see their corpse. The makeup is too much. And her money goes because of, and I'm asking her, all this makeup, he said that as I'm not fine, won't I use makeup to take and help my ministry? So you can see that the level of expenses she's making is making her, she would rather go hungry, but instead, rather she would go hungry so that she can buy makeup. And her money goes into that thing. So people have what is called Parkinson's Law. Parkinson's Law, if you don't watch it, Parkinson's Law says that work expands as to fill the time available for its completion. So that there's more time, there's more work will come. And if you translate it to what we are saying, it's that people say once new level, new devil, new expenses. But it's not true. You determine your expenses.
Yes, yes, yes.
Whether you are the president of a country, you determine. I don't buy. You determine what you want to spend. Don't say now because I'm a manager, I'm a general overseer, so I need to do some certain things so that people will know that I have arrived. Who sent you message in the first place? How would they know whether you have arrived or not? Number five, refusal to let go of a certain kind of lifestyle, even when the income is not coming, we try to maintain a certain style. This is just 5 points. Where do you fall? Now, let's go to business. Let me give you some points. What's my skill set? What is the gift that I have? Because as the owner of the business, your skill that is bringing about the profit must be dominant in that business. Your skills, because as the owner, you are the one that is working the money. What skills do I have? That's one. And how does it affect my business? Because if you don't have the right skill set for that business, then there's a problem. It means that your gift cannot carry your business. There is a problem. Second one is that, what do you have to offer? What is my product or service? What do I have to offer? And to whom do I want to offer these things? To whom? Then also, why am I not able to reach these people that I say that I want to offer to? Why have I not been effective in increasing my sales margin by meeting these people? Why? Then what do I need to improve in my life and in the business so that I can make more money? You need to, if it's a business, I've told you how to exchange your business. You cannot be a successful entrepreneur if all your business is not, every aspect of your business is not in your head. From procurement to manufacturing to sales to customer care, you must close your eyes at night and you know where you need help in your business. Is it in logistics and distribution? You don't have strength there. You partner with people. Where is your problem? That's what is called SWOT analysis. Where is your problem in the business? Then the other one I talked about is personal. Are you spending more? Do you discipline yourself? Please look for where is leaking? Where are the places that money is leaking? Value is ineffective. Relevance is not felt. Once you can locate those things, it means that turnaround has come. Number four is, why was I laid off? To those of you that are working, why was I laid off? Is this something I did? Is this something I did not do? Is it a skill I did not get? Is it a degree that I did not get? If you're working in a degree-based company, Because there are companies, certain companies don't give a damn about your degree. They give a, what they care for is your skill. But certain companies, they care about degree. And you know, first class now is almost like O levels. First class, I say first class, first degree is like WAEC. That to be considered is second degree. Two of us. And so if those of you that want to go to school that say, oh, please be making the budget is master's. That is the first level. Or you do first, then you use other things to garnish it. Because your CV must be garnished. You use project management course, the ones you did 2 weeks, the ones you did 1 week, the ones you did 1 month. And you don't even put the duration, use it to escort and encourage the first degree. If not, nobody will look at you. Is somebody hearing me?
Yeah. For those of you looking for work, first class is WAEC now. First degree is WAEC. So if you are looking, going to the bank or going to places that degree is important, then you have to find small things to, yes, if not, it will not work. Why did I lose the job? Is it because of my anger? Why did I lose my job? Is it because I was not able to play the company politics? I suffered
for company politics for a long time. You know, because the way for me is work. You know, the average believer, I work, then God will promote me. I work, you know, and you see people coming and go. I realized that my biggest mistake was I was working and killing myself, but there was no appraisal. I was here in Port Harcourt dying. Lagos did not know whether I was working or not. People will go to Lagos for me and they will clap for the region and take the glory. I never went because I was deep inside operations. I said, which kind of operations? And that vessel will come and sink here. That I need to go to Lagos. I had to advise myself that I needed to make sure I make free myself to go to Lagos. If not, do you know sometimes they will go there, they will spend 5 days. And they will give, apart from the flight, they will give you, in fact, the level that I was, is anything you spend, you say you spend, they will give it to you back. And I realized that I was working, but nobody was seeing it. So promotion was hard to come because they could not evaluate your success. No, your value that you're bringing in, your relevance. When people cannot see your relevance, they can't promote you now. When people don't see your value. But was God not there? Was God not watching the injustice of man to man? God was watching so that I permitted it to happen so I would learn sense and be able to play. Now I am master. I am master at the game. The way I am rising in the places I belong is because I know how to play to the gallery. In football, let me tell you, when you are 20, 25, 26 that you play, you want to die. But once you enter 30, you begin to find China and play for money. You are not playing for skill again. So when you get to a certain age, you are playing for money. And relevance is what brings money. So if you don't know that I'm relevant, then you will not give me the thing. Do you understand? So why did you lose out? Even in a relationship, why did you lose out? I went to meet a motivational speaker, a younger speaker. He used to live in my essay before he relocated. Always having serious quarrel with the wife. Always having. And I said, but these two people, they love themselves, but it. I said, have you ever asked your wife what is the problem? Or you ever find out? So that day I decided to ask. And the wife just said one thing. He doesn't give me a chance to talk. But because talking is his trade, talking is what he does for a living. So he will talk for himself, talk for her, talk for the children, talk because he's a talkative. But he was almost killing, wrecking his marriage. So he now had to, I said, oh boy, you need to know that everybody has dual. Yes. You have dual personality. Once you come back from work, drop that work this thing and enter husband mode and lover mode, where you will talk less, let her do the talking because you didn't go out. You married a full-time housewife. So when you come into the house, let her do all the talking here and you just be nodding. And even take some things from there and go and speak about.
That's right.
Yes, sir, because you can learn some lessons from her. Why did you fail? You have a childhood friend. Two of you grew up. Then all of a sudden, the child is. What happened? Don't just say he's a stupid boy. Make him go. Maybe because he's not working in Shell. May I let him go? Is it not other people? God will do me. God will do for me. God will give him my own. If you go, stupid boy. But you don't understand it, because he got the job, he became negative. And that negative spirit separated two of you. Who knows, that guy will be in HR and give you a tip that will bring you in. But your negative attitude has separated. Always find out. And let me tell you, in relationships, never close the door. Complete. Leave it a bit ajar. Because you never know who God will use. If you know whoever the thing is, when you quarrel with somebody, analyze it. I do that. I analyze it well. Because when you do that, it's easy for you to say, I am sorry. But when you don't analyze it, you feel that you're right. And you know, man by nature feels he's always right. But most times we're wrong. So you need to critically assess. Number four, please start doing something, no matter how small. When you're broke, start doing something. I was talking to my elder brother and he said, in the UK, which I believe in the Western world, he said, even people that have good jobs, on the side, they go to do Uber. They go to drive. And I told one of my cousins, can't you try this Uber thing? He said, for what? After working in a bank. For what? You see, it's not the low job. See what happens. If you lose something, you lose your job, you are not doing anything. See, this brain, if it's not active, after a while it begins to diminish. And you get to, you see that, you see some people, you wonder, this one get brain, so I'm sure most of us have talked about this. You know why you say that? Because they have not, they are not exercising the use of their mind creatively. What work does for you is that it gives you that creative ability to continue to think. So when you don't do anything and say, I'm praying God to God, I will get another bank job, even better. Your mind is becoming idle and reducing. Before you know it, the things that you think you know before, you don't know. You don't have strength. If you don't use your mind, you lose strength. It's just like if you don't lose your limbs, you lie down in a bed for a long time, you can't walk. The same thing with the mind. Blood is not flowing there, so it's not moving. So what happens now is that you get to a point, you have become totally dull. You don't have what to do. And that's the problem that most young men have. In thinking that they are looking for deal, they are looking for big deal and this, and they are not exercising their mind on a daily basis. God does not reward big deal. God rewards faithfulness in small things. So it doesn't matter. Start something small. Do you know that many people have started something small and have turned into a billion-dollar business?
Yes, sir.
Something small. You know what? It's not even to. It's not because you can even have 5 million reserve. That's not what I'm saying. It's not the money that you have reserved in, or the money you have in your bank. It's your mind that I'm after. It's your mind. So you must continue to utilize your mind. You must continue to utilize your mind. If not, it will become docile. There are many things, many, many things that you can do. I don't know if some of you remember this Cleo Hart, Simon Hart.
Yeah.
Eh?
Yeah.
Came to, she came, was it not a cake she brought? She was doing cake and she had supplies all over Port Harcourt. And she told us she learned it from the internet. Some of you were there when she said it was from the internet. Why don't you learn how to bake from the internet? Why you are still looking for that big job? Okay? Other things, turn your hobby into a job. What do you like to do? Turn it into a job. For those of you that can do jewelry, sell it at a local fair. Do it. And now you have places on the internet that you can put it and people can buy. I told a young man that is working now, I said, look, go to your village and snap whatever that you see there. If it's plantain, if it's whatever, snap it and put it on Jumia or put it anywhere and tell them within 2 days it costs this. After 3 days it costs this. Go to your village and start that. That's what he does now. He goes anywhere he sees anything, he goes. He will just start, and it's working. Some people go to refurbish, take the carcass of the furniture that's been thrown away and they use it to refurbish it and they will go and sell. Even to bring it to people that are doing furniture, they might sell something, they might buy it from you, or you people can come have an agreement, they sell, they give you commission. You can sell anything that you want. There are many. If you are an instrumentalist in church, how can you now be looking for work? If you can play the piano, guitar, there are many people that want their children to learn. There are many things that you can do. How about breeding dogs? You can breed dog, you can breed a rabbit, anything that you want. See, it's not, even if it's not where you are going, for the sake of your mind, do something. And you realize that when you are doing that thing, God will lead you to something else that will open your eyes. Number 5, determine what you can live without. What do I mean by that? Cut costs. Cut costs. Reduce your lifestyle. When there is no income, when the income is not coming as it should, reduce, cut down. Look at the things that you can live without and cut down. And for you to effectively do that, you need to track your money and see where your money is going. Let me give you an assignment. From 1st of May, buy a small jotter. Buy a small jotter and a pen. Let it be with you everywhere you go. And put different categories of what you buy. Categorize it and put how much you spend so that you can actually know where your money goes. Most of us, we don't know our money trail. Most of us, we don't know our money trail. You will be surprised where your money is going. Are you going to do that? If you don't do it, you will not be able to effectively control your funds. For those of us that have app, I think there's an app that can give. If not, if you don't have app, write it. Like what? Like now, office or shop, office shop. What do you spend there in terms of if you don't have it in the shop? that you spend on fuel, on transport, whatever you do. If you have a car, fueling, what do you spend on fuel? Then what do you spend in the house? What do you shop in? What do you for the month, for the week? Then another one you need to capture, your own personal shopping that is not thought of. The gala you buy, the water you buy, anything that you see, because that's where the problem is. The discipline is in the one you do for yourself. Some people say, it's not the best way it's dying the work. That's when the indiscipline comes. Because you are the one working it, you are now spending. That personal spending, whatever it is, when it passes transport to house and office, you put transportation from office to house. If you branch anywhere, for those of you that like to branch, that branching is personal expenses. It's not, because it's not that office one. That one you are doing, put a cost to it. Make I just take mineral here, make I, let me just eat this. It's not because you are hungry, let me just enter spa there. I escort people, let me just enjoy myself. That is where the money goes. You'll be surprised that your wife is shouting. You'll be telling your wife, you are spending too much money in this house. It's not the wife, it's that personal expenses that you just put to, because it's in your pocket. I do that. And the first day I did it, I realized, wow, the problem is in personal spending. Because now, if you should be able to know the amount of fuel, that the cost that you use if you have a car. How much does it cost you in a week to do your rounds? So if you, it's not because you don't have money to fill the tank. No, it's financial discipline. So you budget 5K or 6K if you have a fuel efficient car. 5K, see, this will do. So on Monday, I don't need to go out now, it's meeting days, let me call. So you are budgeting that money on calls. Tuesday I'll go out, Wednesday I'll go out, Thursday I'll go out, depending on your marketing strategy. Friday I'll stay back. So you know 5,000, 6,000. Then it's different from weekend expenses, that you go out with your wife and you go to church and do all those things. You can even include it, but have a budget. That when the fuel is getting to quarter tank and you have abused the fuel, you just sit down at home. If your wife says, let's go, you say, I know they go because I've expended that this day. If you don't discipline yourself, it's not that, oh, your wife has said, let's put fuel and move on. No. If it's not emergency, you don't need to do it. When you are trying to build your funds, a day will come you have filling station, so it doesn't matter whether you use fuel. They will even be begging your car, your allocation for the month, you have not used it. But when the cash is low, you have to cut costs. You have to reduce the bouquet you are using in DSTV. Maybe you go for GoTV. You have to reduce the bouquet now. There are many. You have to reduce. Sometimes the DSTV itself, sometimes in the house, it's not that you don't know that the subscription has expired. You just bone first. If nobody notices, you just bone. And by the time you reach halfway, next month now, you have to find an excuse to save money. You have to let eating out, some people, Sunday, they must buy special something. You can reduce it to once in a month. Once in a month. So one day there was my kids, you always buy them, you must be as if going to church is party. After church, you must buy them certain something. My wife came and said, we need to. I say, we are not this one. Tell them that. Say they are holiday now. That I say, no, this Sunday. We're all going home. He said they will not be happy. I said, it's all right. I'm their father. They will forgive me. Because if you say because of children now, you go and spend everything, then when critical something comes, what will you do? If it's not flowing, as you should, and you need to cut, you need to cut costs. Number six, stop digging. If you're in a hole, stop digging. Stop digging. The more you are struggling to come out, the more you're struggling to make things meet, you are struggling and you're spending money and say, ah, this thing, I need this business. You don't know it, but let me just take this small money and let me just put it into this business, and you don't even know the business. You are trying to crawl out from a ditch. When you already down, a strategy that will bring you out. Stop trying to spend money and stop trying to do things to make it look as if you're not broke, to make it look as if things are flowing. You are still moving as if things are the same. You need to stop struggling to get out. What you need God's help. You need sound counsel. You need good people around you, and you need to make wise decisions. In the multitude of counselors, there is safety. It's now for you to move strategically. It's not time to try everything. Some people, when the money is low, you see them trying to do everything. And in the bit of running helter-skelter, they will get into more problems. That's continue to dig when you're inside the hole. Don't do that. You already need, what you need now is the strategy to come out. The grace and the help of God. So please halt every activity and look for the one activity that will bring you out. And stop trying to make it work by force. Number seven. This might sound, I know it's been abused, but the truth must be told. Sowing. You give your way out of poverty. Listen to me like this, because Christians, well, this has been abused for so long. So when they say sowing, people begin to get very, you give your way out of poverty. You give your way. You have to take care of the spiritual. The spiritual rules the physical. And the spiritual, in the spiritual realm, in the spiritual realm is the highest bidder that we do. A man slaughtered his first son, didn't he defeat Israel? Even when he told Israel that you are going to win this war, he slaughtered his first son. He made that sacrifice and he beat back. He beat back Israel. You use resources to break the devourer of your life and the life of your children. And let me explain. I will. Those that have ears, let them hear. Because some people, their mind has been, you know,
sealed. Luke 16.
Jesus said, he said that the children of this world are in their own way wiser than the children of light. Why? Because he used mammon. How did he say? He used unrighteous mammon to gain friends. I have told you many times how I'm able to talk to, get into the midst of influential and rich people is with gifts. See, those people that manager was giving that favor to, they are his August friends, so they are wealthy people. You use favor. In the marketplace, favor is traded for favor. Where you don't trade with cash, you use favor. I employ your brother, you employ my sister. That's what is understood. I help you out at the time. I'm waiting for my own time when you become governor and you owe me, sir. It's an unspoken rule in the marketplace and in high places. That man used, but he says, use unrighteous mammon to gain friends. Use money to gain friends, and we all know it. It's not easy, it's not hard for us to give to a rich man, for those that have sense. that understand, not says that have this knowledge. It's not easy. You can belong, you can pay 200,000 to come into Chamber of Commerce because you know you will be among those high and mighty. A man that trained, a man that all of us look up to, and he came to Port Harcourt. Did I tell you where I bought drink of 180,000 naira first, went for one round? And it was alcohol, and I'm a pastor. But I needed to break into, because in the marketplace, nobody cares who you serve. I don't take alcohol, neither do I encourage it. But I needed to get to where there are people that hold the keys to this city. There are people that hold the keys. People own cities. People own the marketplace. And you have to be able to assess them so that the wealth of the wicked will come to the righteous. It's not in your house that the wealth of the wicked will come to the righteous. You have to make it. You have to go in there. You have to go in there. People come for trade fair. In the Chamber of God, even in my own exhibition, when I go around with important people, anything they pick, I buy for them. Anything. I can't see a pastor. I agree in his anointing. I acknowledge his anointing. I see a rich man somewhere that I will not give him a gift. And the trick I use is that I will do something that will make you not forget me in the next 1 month. So the way he see me is, I saw a woman that a couple. I didn't even see them. They were trying me at the airport. I was trying to catch a flight. And they were looking. And the wife was saying, that's the man that did this thing for you. You see, not that marketplace. She was saying marketing place, apostles or something. You know, says that is the man. The woman remembered the gift I gave the man, but the man didn't remember. I was saying, is it not? You use unrighteous mammon to get. You cannot have the. See, let me. You can't have a rich friend, and you are coming. They are tired of people asking them. Rich people will remember you when you give them something first. Give them something. Give them something of value. I don't want to call name, but there's a politician. He wanted a position. If I say it, all of you would know. He wanted a position. He went to the chairman of his party. The man was crazy about watches. Gave him two watches that the man knows the price. As he brought the watches, the man said, Jesus, who can give me this? He said, what do you want? He said, "What, my son, what do you want? Your gift makes room for you. What do you want? You can't be rich and be stingy. You must give. You use unrighteous mammon to give. And all of us can reckon with this. You have been shaking your head and say yes. But that is physical. How about the spiritual realm? How about the spiritual realm? That's where confusion sets in. Because we can see man. This is a wealthy man. If I give him, he will. But this man is wealthy because of God. But give to God because you are not seeing God directly. You feel that God loves us now. It's the same strategy. It's the same strategy for physical and for spiritual. Give to spiritual things. Solomon sacrificed 1,000 offerings. God said, who be this person? And asked him what he wanted that night. He asked for wisdom. God gave him Jara because of his offering. Did we read it in the Bible? How about Gideon? Gideon sacrificed and what he had body. When the angel met Gideon, he was complaining about his nation Israel. Seriously complaining. And saying, this is not what our forefathers said to us. But when he caught the revelation, he gave a sacrifice and what God spoke. Say, this is where the problem is. And as that problem was removed, he blew the shofar and everybody gathered round. Some of you are struggling in ministry. You've not broken that. You've not broken that. That the You have not broken the heavens. You have not with your giving. Where is the devil? When they ask, where is the devil? Where is he resting? Under. That's what we think. We look down. The devil is in the first heaven. Where is the prince of Persia? Where is the prince of the spirit of the air? He's in the spirit. He's in the first heaven. Where was he that they resisted the prayer of Daniel? Was he not from the heavens? He roams everywhere. You use your giving to break through. Don't let anybody lie and deceive you. But the caveat here is, you have to give as you are led by the Spirit. If not, it's free will donation. If the Holy Spirit doesn't convict you to give, there is free will offering. Abraham gave a sacrifice. Abraham was complaining and said that, see, the person that is going to become my heir in this house is not my son. What did God say? He said, get a sacrifice. God cannot speak without sacrifice. The backbone of covenant, of wealth cannot be, or poverty cannot be broken without sacrifice. Don't let anybody deceive you. The rich will always become richer because of their covenant, whether good or bad. Do you know that companies do sacrifice? Oil companies. Who has worked in any oil company? Do you see them? Do you know that they do sacrifice? Every year they go into the waters. I don't want to call names. They go into water and they do sacrifice. Before a ship leaves the what do they call it? Harbor. Don't they break wine, break drinks and do? Who are they sacrificing to? What are they breaking wine for? Before you go to a body, my dear, don't they look at what and pour libation before they enter? They understand that these things are the people of this world. They understand this, but we don't understand that with this spiritual, with this giving, why are you giving as an entrepreneur? Why is it important? You give because God needs to, as when God sends the blessing, there will be no interruption. And God knows that you're a faithful steward, that you will give to for his kingdom work, but you need to use your giving. Isaac sowed in the land, he reaped. Jesus gave his life so that we believe. Have you not wondered the two widows? One is saying, go and make me cake. The woman is telling you, I want to do this and die. He said, go and give me first. The other one built a penthouse for the prophet. Then the prophet gave him a son. The prophet prayed for a son. The woman, just recognizing a prophet, she had a son. Even when the son died, he raised him back to life. You give to God through his establishment, through his prophets, through his people, through his work. It's because you don't see him and you are looking. Since when are we, because we still have the eye that a pastor should not drive a new car, a pastor should not wear this. So we feel that when you give to him, you are giving to a man, you are giving to God. Once he releases, is who did you give? It's a spiritual thing. We don't give as a faith, that's why we are having issues. Christians, in quotes, are not rich because we don't know the power of giving. In other faiths, alms, giving of alms is a major pillar in their faith. Giving alms is a requirement by religion to give and not give small. And in that faith, when they want to build their temple, it doesn't take them anything because everybody comes out to build. But we still don't understand this concept of giving. The Bible says, give, it shall be given unto you. Press down, shake it together, running over. Don't let anybody deceive you. You give your way out of poverty. If you're still struggling with tithes, I'm sorry. Because we have moved beyond the age of tithes. We have moved into the age of taking care of our father's business. We should be building churches, not giving 10%. Some of us, the 10% mean nothing. But we are building our father's houses because we understand that this is a king. We are in a relationship with him. Take care of the spiritual, and you will be surprised in victory you get. The people of this world, they know. From 12 o'clock, go to T junctions. You will see sacrifices that are put. How many of us have seen it? We see it all the time. What are they doing? They are taking care of the spiritual realm in their own way. And that's why you are seeing progress and progress. But when it comes to us and say, leave them, they won't drop us. They won't drop you. That's why you have no power spiritually. That's why that nothing is fighting for you without sacrifice. Now we don't do any sacrifice of lamb. Jesus has done the sacrifice. So it's our seed. Your seed, your money is you. It represents you. Nothing can represent you more than your money. Nothing. It's your resources. It's coming from you. It's the work of your hand. It's your sweat. It is you. And when you give, it breaks the backbone. A word is enough for the wise. Read this book, Seek Faith, Kenneth Oral Roberts. Then read Kenneth Copeland. Kenneth Copeland. There's two books. For those of you that go to Winners, you know that book by Kenneth Copeland's wife that he said he read.
The Law
of Prosperity. The one by his wife.
Gloria.
Gloria, yes. God's will is prosperity. He said that was where he got the revelation. That he said, I can never be poor. That's when I even cut the interest. I said, by which power is this man saying I will never be poor? Because he cut it. He's a powerful giver even to the ministry of Kenneth Copeland. I'm a partner with Kenneth Copeland. He will tell you, when they started it, or a robot, he will tell you that they will go to meetings, they don't know where to come in different, and then God will say, give that watch or give that money. They went to a meeting the first day. They had $100 for everything. God said, give. Before the meeting ended, in 3 days, they had $1,000. They had $1,000. Somebody gave Gloria Copeland a watch. In the book, he said, you see it. And the Lord said, she sold it. She got one better within that same. But it's led by the Spirit. Why it looks as if it's not working is when you want to use your kalu mind. This pastor don't come now. I have $1 million, let me go and sow it. And I will see, he said $100, but so it's times 10. So this 100,000 now is like $1 million. When the motive, as soon as the motive is not right, God is not there. When you enter a meeting, say, Holy Spirit, minister, what I should give. If you don't get the leading, that's why if you don't have the power of the Holy Spirit, you will be missing a lot of things. And some of us, the Holy Spirit is telling us to give, saying, I'm like, this is what can be the Holy Spirit. This is everything that I have. So the children will start, no, God is not that wicked. But God is teaching you obedience and total reliance on Him. Learn to give by the Spirit. That is where we miss it. Because if you don't give by the Spirit, it's free will donation. And those ones too also have that. Those things that you give that you don't know, that's why you don't have accident. That's why your wife delivered well. All those offerings that you give that are not left, they are working for your own good. They are bringing mercy and injustice and all those things that you don't know that you didn't pray for. But the one that is laid in your heart, look for a soil. Enter anywhere, ask the Lord, is there anything I can do here? As you came in here, say, let me tell the ask this man of God, what can I do according to my own pocket for this place? Since I know that the presence of God is here. Or you just say, God, what can I do? You will lay it in your hands. When you do it, that one doesn't take time. You will see the reward immediately. Immediately. But when you come and you fear, I should give, and you don't, our religious mind, let me just give. That one, God will still bless you. But make sure any powerful conference or event you go to, please leave something substantial. Give the Holy Spirit. Ask the Holy Spirit, what should I do? This way, many people are broken. The last one is avoid borrowing. The borrower is a slave to the lender. It's what the Bible says. In all things, try as much as possible. If you have to borrow, let it that borrowing be for assets, not liability. What do I mean? That borrowing must be making money and not spending money. Don't borrow to buy a car. Don't borrow to build a house. Don't borrow to build some to get something that is not giving you returns. Don't borrow to do that. You can borrow for business, you can borrow for expansion, you can borrow to start a business, but let it be calculated profit that you know is going to come. You can borrow, but don't borrow to go and eat. Don't borrow to buy clothes. Don't go and collect something. You see people that are saying, buy this bag, now buy this shoe for women. You go and collect, you don't have money, but you believe that you will pay. Don't go and get, because they will start calling you. Some people will give you something and say, don't worry, I will not disturb you. After 2 weeks, they're calling you every day. Borrow to make money. Let your borrowing be against assets, not in liability. Hallelujah. Let's start to our faith and charge ourselves with the Spirit as we get ready for a few prayer points.